This is why you are my people. So Taylor, you want to come on?
Sure. Like I said earlier, I'm Taylor Sharp. I am from Best Friends Animal Society. So thank you very much for giving me the time to speak today. I love how this worked out. A lot of what I have to say is going to play off what Jane had to say. So hopefully this is cohesive for you. So I'm here to talk about what Best Friends is doing and kind of their vision and strategies going forward. So very broad. So, obviously this is a picture of me. I like to throw in a picture of my dog when I present because people tend to be more excited about animals than they are about me, which I think is totally fair. I'm the same. I like to picture this cat. That made a little presentation. So, like I said earlier, my title is the No More Homeless Pets Network Specialist. It is the single most vague job description, job title that I have ever heard. I'll explain a little bit more later, but essentially that means I work with all of our partners in Alaska, California, Hawaii, Oregon, and Washington on literally anything that has to do with your operations, anything that impacts animal lives. So the full gamut. So a little bit about Best Friends. If you have not heard of us before, we were an organization founded in 1984. They try to distance themselves a little bit from this, but the truth is we were founded by a group of hippies who were in the South and kind of saw way too many animals dying and decided to do something about it. So they bought thousands of acres of land in Utah. This is a picture from our sanctuary. The blurriness does not do it justice. It's amazing, I know I'm biased, but it is a gorgeous place, and at any one time, they'll have about 1,800 animals there. They do dogs and cats, but also barnyard animals, small animals, and then a few wildlife as they come in and is needed. So essentially, this group started to take in dogs and cats. They got a little bit overwhelmed, but were doing incredible work. And they decided, let's see how we can have more of an impact. And they decided to reach out to other organizations, reach out for community support. So that is kind of the start of their effort in collaboration. It then evolved into working throughout the entire state of Utah. From there was many iterations of this, but we have now created the No More Homeless Pets Network. Again, a very long name. It has had like five different names, but we're sticking with No More Homeless Pets Network because we don't want to rebrand everything that is too expensive. So, the network is focused on obviously networking, collaboration, resources, which is both financial and educational, being people, paper, things like that. And then expanding the boundaries of life saving, really looking at innovative ways we can help beyond just your stereotypical intake. That's it. So this now is kind of, we have different components of it. We have the network specialist. We also have 10 community cat programs that we're running in larger cities where we go in, work with the large city shelter and implement a TNR program for 3 years. It's done wonderful things. I'm super excited about it. We also have our legislative team that works predominantly on breed discrimination issues as well as community cat issues. We have a team of lawyers that goes into the communities where it's most necessary, and you know, they lobby, they go in, they speak on the floor, do wonderful things. So lucky to have them. We also have Puppy Mill Initiatives team, and then our shelter support team, which is new and evolving, but we've brought on some really great people. I sound like bragging, but they are great people from kind of the sheltering world to come in and support our efforts. So we are super excited about them. You will soon learn I am a visual person. So here's your first map. This map represents where all of our partners are at. So you can see, obviously, there's a heavy concentration in the cities. If you're looking in Washington, let's say, Washington, Portland, you know, LA, San Francisco areas. So it's pretty spread out. We have a decent representation of organizations in non-metro areas, but that is something we're very much looking to expand on. So as of last night, at about midnight, when I pulled this together, we had 1,976 total partners. And these are in all 50 states. I know that Alaska and Hawaii are not pictured here, but we are just bad at getting maps together. So sorry about that. These organizations vary in intake. I looked it up, but I think our smallest organization had an intake of 2 cats, and our largest intake was over 50,000 animals. So we are all over the board with the size of organizations we work with. As of now, only about 20% of our partners are shelters across the country. The reason for this is when the network was established. Obviously, Best Friends is a grassroots organization. So grassroots groups, small rescues, identified more permission. They were the first one to jump on the bandwagon. We so appreciate the work that we're doing, but we are absolutely putting more of an emphasis on shelters and really working to expand that. I think within about, the last 6 months, we have had over 100 municipalities join. So we're growing quickly. That's pretty exciting. In our region alone, there are over 390 partners, so pretty heavily represented. The state of Washington is doing wonderfully. I so appreciate how many of you are represented on this map and how many of you are partners. It's great. One, to see all of you here and also to meet some people that you've been emailing with for like 18 months. So from there, we have this network. What are we going to do with it? What makes sense? Like I said earlier, Best Friends is always looking for new ways to really impact animal welfare and make sure that we're being efficient and effective. So we divided the country up into 8 different regions. We have the stars represent our regional centers. We have LA, Salt Lake City, our sanctuary, Atlanta, and New York City right now. Very, very long-term goal would probably be to have a regional center in each of the regions, but again, that is extremely long-term. So we are now taking more of a regional approach, having one regional specialist at least per region, and now we have new regional directors. Ours is Jose Ocano. If anyone knows him from Pima, he is amazing. He will hopefully be out here sooner rather than later to meet all of you and to get a better understanding of your work, but incredibly excited about having him here. So now that we have regions, what do we do going forward? We need some sort of goal. So in 2016, the leaders of our organization decided to take a giant leap and jump our goal by 5 years. So we are focusing on the year 2025. That is going to be branded everywhere. As you were at the conference saw, we say it a lot. But by the year, the end of 2025, Best Friends would like to take the nation's shelters no-kill. Yes, we do use no-kill language. I know that that is controversial. I will put in a side note, we don't care at all what language you use, as long as you are in the game to help more dogs, help more cats. Not that we don't care about other animals, but right now we're focused on dogs and cats. You are a people. We're in agreement. So yes, we do use no-kill language, but we don't care what you call that, 90%, whatever. So for us, we are defining our goal of no-kill as a 90% live release rate. We know that that doesn't necessarily mean all healthy treatables are going to be in that 90%, but that we just need something tangible. So by the end of 2025, we are going to help get the nation to no-kill. So map number 2 or 3. This is our first step. So we made this big goal. What do? We had a team of about 80 people. Unfortunately, we didn't have 80 genes. We wanted really clone you. I hope that's okay. We're gonna submit for it. But we essentially called all the municipalities that we could find listed and gathered as much data as possible. This was a huge undertaking. Not everyone is a data nerd like me. I found this to be really exciting, but others did not. So what we found is the nation's live release rate is roughly 69%. So for shelters all throughout the country, 69%. So 58.3% of this data was collected and reported to us directly from online or from the shelter need, whatever it might be. That does mean that 41.7% of this data was estimated or inferred. We will say that a lot of this is really educated guessing. It's not perfect by any means, but looking at population and neighboring shelters, this is probably a pretty good guess of where things stand. So there were 19 states that gave us complete data, thank you, Janine. And then the rest of it was bits and pieces. Because at this point, we don't even have a full count of how many shelters there are in the country, which is a huge flaw. So we did the best that we could, and hopefully this is going to get us a little bit further on our understanding of where things are at. So if you're looking at our region specifically, the colored dots kind of represent where states as a whole stand for life release rate. Alaska is the state that we have the absolute least data about. It's very spread out and kind of, I don't want to say chaotic, but it's different than it's done in Washington, to say the least. So we know that there are various forms of animal control that aren't great and they don't track number of animals. So we have this data from several of the large organizations, but that's about it. So our best guess is that the live release rate is about 40%, but we're not 100% on that. Next would be California. So California is a really interesting state for us because there's parts of it that are doing really, really well and parts of it that are not at all. So California represents 12% of the total animals in the United States dying in shelters. So 12% is huge. I understand that their population kind of, it makes more sense. However, of that 12%, roughly 9% are in Southern California alone. So that would be just like this lower area right here, which is very disproportionate. We're working on that. So if you have thoughts or connections here, please, let's talk. The next would be Hawaii. As many of you know, because you are transport partners with them, they have a lot of cats, and some of the islands even have a lot of dogs. So they're like, I can't, how my glass is that bad. I'd say 47%. We're gonna go with 47. Then next is Oregon. Oregon rounded up is at 90%, which is fantastic. In large part thanks to ASAP, and there's other areas that need some help, but as a state they're doing pretty good. And you just saw all Washington's information, so I don't need to be ultra redundant there. So we've gathered data now. We, as much as we would love to have 80 people do this constantly and get new data, it's not feasible. So we have invested heavily and are firm believers in Shelter Animals Count. I know I'm going to jump on the bandwagon, and you're going to hear about it later, but this is really the only way for us to have a better understanding of where things are at and in a non-judgmental fashion get the actual numbers. I think it was a really important point to say some people are afraid to report their data, and we're hoping that the messaging of Shelter Animals Count is, hey, it doesn't matter, we know that you're trying, we want to support you, please report. So this number is old. I think they have now officially crossed 4,200 participating shelters, which is amazing and huge. So we've done this data, now what? And our focus is obviously going to be with our network partners. We want to focus on all of these programs. Our main focus is TNR and RTF. It's huge. We really believe in it. And we want to provide as much support as possible. Then we have the animals and kittens, progressive adoption, aggressive foster. I can go through all of this. You can just read it. That's better, in my opinion. So we are looking to help implement any of these programs, support any of these programs, provide guidance, whatever you might need on any of these. So please, if you have thoughts on this, if you have questions, that is what Best Friends in the Network is all about, is really providing resources, connecting you with experts in certain topics, things along those lines. That's what we want to do. Most importantly, we believe in the power of coalitions and collaboration. This is our other big kind of hot topic that we will repeat all over. We know that it is not super easy to do, but as Best Friends learned personally, and as we have seen continuously over for all of our work. The only way we achieve our goal is by working together. That's just how it is. We see animal welfare as a group responsibility. So, you know, the animals in Seattle aren't just Seattle Humane and Seattle Animal Shelter's responsibility. We kind of see it as everyone's. These are everyone's animals, and we've got to work together. So maybe that makes me sound like a hippie, but I do have best friends, so that's where we stand. It's also important to note, I have actually been tasked with creating a coalition building toolkit, which I want to say will come out soon, but our copywriters can take a while. So I don't know if anyone has seen our Community Cat handbook. It has 58 chapters. It's massive. We're looking to build something not quite that big, but hopefully that informational. So more to come if you are interested in that. Again, I have cards. Let's talk. I'd love to share that out when it does get approved. So a good example of this, just to emphasize how much we believe in collaboration and supporting organizations, is we work with Positive Alliance and Yakima Humane Society to bring Scott Giacopo and Holly Sizemore out to Yakima to do a presentation to support their Valley Cats program. So essentially, Scott came out to meet with those groups and also anyone in the community that really wanted to be a part of this and talk about, okay, what are the best approaches to return field in TNR? How do you diffuse situations with hostile citizens? The full gamut, and we then provided lots of opportunities for questions, resources, and also did some ride-alongs with the ACOs. So this is just a good example. I can't guarantee that we'll do this everywhere, but of how much we firmly believe in collaboration, supporting coalitions that are doing good work, and getting these programs implemented. So going forward, my ideal world would be, if you aren't a part of the network, please, please, please join the network. We would love to help you. It is completely free. I try really hard to not sound like a telemarketer when I give this pitch, but it is free, and I encourage you to talk to someone that is a partner, because they'll be able to tell you in a more candid fashion than I probably can, and it'll likely more believable because it isn't their job. So join the network. We would ideally like to see coalitions in every state or every region of the state. That's what we want to work towards. So if we can assist in building task force, working on setting up a board, something along those lines for a coalition, we would love that. And then we would be happy to collaborate with you as much or as little as you see fit when needed. We don't want to, push ourselves in when we're not wanted, but we do want to help wherever possible. So please don't hesitate to reach out for help or to tell us to bug off. We're totally fine with that. So that is all I have, because I tried. Janine took a lot of my stuff, which I'm so grateful. But does anyone have any questions? Yes.
How can you support a coalition for our reserve example of our state coalition that Best Friends is working with?
Sure. So we have a couple statewide coalitions that we're working with in the South. We have a couple statewide coalitions in the South that we are currently supporting. Right now, their specialist is Emily, and so where she is at within the process is they set up an initial kind of task force where we go over, okay, who are the key players, what are your goals, what do the finances look like, etc. So really pulling in those top members. We were able to facilitate that. We actually brought in a professional facilitator to do that because there were some dynamics in our shocker. Animal welfare has dynamics. And then from there, we also facilitated the next kind of statewide meeting, as well as providing guidance and resources on that. There was some financial assistance. I'm hesitant to say that because I can't guarantee financial assistance, but for organizations that are doing good work and doing coalition type work, there's a new system for financial assistance, so I would be happy to put a good word on that one. So does that answer your question? Is that way too big?
No, it's perfect. As the state moves into the regional field first, Washington would like to be an example.
I agree.
Use the network.
I agree. I guess, and I should say
that's
this.
Well,
you are already an example. People are already looking to you. It's very interesting to listen to the conversations you have about, tame cats coming into the shelter and, oh, we can get them placed. That's not a conversation being had most places. I come from a shelter background in Nebraska and Iowa, which looks dramatically different than this. So I'm very happy to be here and to hear those conversations being had. But the nation is looking to you. Your organizations are kind of being the leaders right now, whether you know it or not. Throughout all of our national calls that we have, we talk about, okay, so the South is doing this, what is the Northeast doing? Northeast is also doing great, but right now there's a huge spotlight on the Pacific Northwest, specifically Washington, and I'm so excited for what you all can do to kind of influence sheltering going forward. It's a great opportunity. And I'm really excited. I live in Seattle, so getting the chance to have my home state represented is amazing. Yes.
Taylor, I'm not sure if you know this or not, but it seemed like for the work you were doing in LA for quite a while, and also involved a lot of transferring, which obviously a lot of these groups were taking from,
yep.
And then that just went away. Do you know why that happened? If there's going to be more of that effort?
Sure. So that's a great question. Essentially how that evolved was some of the transports, like Put My Ride, were coming from LA County, which didn't support the LA City goal necessarily. They're two different entities. So that was a change because they were spending finances on the county, which wasn't impacting goals in the city. And also emphasis on we need to work locally and support more local work. While yes, we have this goal to bring Los Angeles to no kill, that's no more important than getting the cats in Washington saved. So if an organization has the opportunity to pull cats locally, then we want to support that. And I think we weren't necessarily doing a great job of helping facilitate that. And that's kind of where we realized we were at. So not to be a shortage in terms of things, but we realized we need to improve our strategy. We are open to if there is a shortage of cats, we've got plenty. We've got dogs, whatever you need, they can be moved up. We just have kind of decreased those efforts.
And is that something that we would go through?
Yep. That's the easiest presentation I've ever done. No other questions.
Kay, were you using that as a kind of a hypothetical or real situation that there is a need for cats?
Well, I think what happens for a lot of us that do big transfers, there are certain times of year, right, where there's turkeys available, and you know, we have stakes. And, you know, we want to connect with groups like Harriet's. But there's also, you know, maybe there is an opportunity to pull from Southern California because you can actually see them flown out. Or maybe there's a struggle to get across the mountains, right? So I think for all of us that are looking to make sure that we're still having as many animals as possible, when that pipeline ended with no communication about it, there was a void. And, you know, eventually, again, because of great work that is happening in California, we're always still looking for who still has a need, and let's make sure we have that connection that we can talk about.
Sure, and I'm sorry if I downplayed or made it sound negative on taking cats from California. If you have empty cats and you are an organization that wants to save more animals, that is amazing. So I'm sorry if I gave the wrong impression on that. We fully support that. We just weren't taking the right approach at that point.
It seems to me, too, like, we have a transport coordinator because we're big enough to do that. She has built relationships in Oregon and Washington, but it's over California.